Amen. So I got an exciting sermon for you tonight, or this afternoon, about usury. You're like, what is usury? Some of you may be like, what is usury? So I've had a couple people actually randomly ask me questions about usury. Now, usury is dealing with interest, okay? Like loans, you know, getting interest. Basically, you kind of think of the word, it's usury on money. So it's basically making money using someone else's money or using a bit of money to get interest or gain money basically on that. So I want to kind of talk about this as far as what the Bible teaches concerning usury. And because I've had people ask, you know, like, well, is it wrong for me to work at a bank, you know, or at a credit union and or something like that? And I'm going to get my thoughts on this as far as what the Bible teaches on this. Now, in most cases in the Bible, and usury is not exactly mentioned a whole bunch. It's mentioned a little bit, but in most cases, it's not in a good light. It's basically saying don't put usury on your money and you know, basically getting interest based off that. Okay, go to Proverbs chapter 28. So, well, first of all, you saw in Psalm 15 and verse 5, it says, "He that putteth not his money to usury, nor taketh reward against the innocent, he that doeth these things shall never be moved." So he's talking about, you know, he that walketh uprightly, you know, like all these things, they'll be the ones that are going to be blessed. All that stuff is the ones that does not put out his money on usury. Okay. Now go to Proverbs 28. Proverbs 28 and verse 8. Proverbs 28 and verse 8. It says, "He that by usury and unjust gain increaseth his substance, he shall gather it for him that will pity the poor." Okay, so in both those verses, it's not in a good light, meaning that if you're righteous, you're not going to put your money out on usury. You're not going to use that to get increase. Okay, so usury, if you just looked it up in a dictionary, basically here's the first couple definitions of usury: the lending or practice of lending money at an exorbitant interest. An exorbitant amount, number two, exorbitant amount or rate of interest, especially in excess of the legal rate. Okay, so when you hear the term usury today, or as we jokingly said, jujury, when you hear that term, you're usually thinking of like predatory lending and really high interest rates that are increasing or movable and all that stuff, right? So, you know, that's the terminology that's used today. I do not believe that's what the Bible means by usury. Okay, if you look at the next definition of it, and this is called the obsolete, or you would say archaic use of it, is interest paid for the use of money. Interest paid for the use of money. Now, I believe that usury is used in that general sense. It's just meaning like basically interest or increase made off of money. Okay, and so whether that be good or bad with what the Bible teaches, I do not believe that when it's saying usury, it just means something that's exorbitant or a high rate, okay? Actually, I don't have it in my notes, but there's a place in Nehemiah where it talks about how he's rebuking them because he's basically causing his brethren to have to pay usury, and it was like 1%, okay? Now, you would look at that and be like, man, I'd like to have a 1% interest rate, you know, on my loan. You know, that sounds pretty good. That being said, so it's not, when it's using usury, it's not talking about exorbitant, okay? And so that being said, let's go into the Bible knowing that, okay, usury is just talking about interest that's made on money, or as it would say, interest paid for the use of money, okay? And this doesn't necessarily mean it's always talking about a loan, okay? It could be talking about investments, it could be talking about different things, but go to Exodus chapter 22, the first place that we'll see here. Now, what's interesting is that most of the time when you're dealing with usury or God rebuking somebody for, you know, putting usury on somebody, is usually talking about doing it to the poor, okay? Meaning that you're afflicting the poor people and causing them to basically become your servant or become your, indentured bond servant or something like that, okay? Now, this is true, and I'll read this verse to you. Proverbs 22 and verse 7, it says, "The rich ruleth over the poor, and the borrower is servant to the lender," okay? Now, that's just a true statement, okay? Whether there's usury or not, the borrower is servant to the lender, right? Because if someone loans you money, whether there's interest on it or not, you know, you owe that person that money, okay? So when you think about this whole thing, is the idea is that you want to try not to be in debt. You want to try not to, but I think most people are in the case of, like, you're paying usury, okay? And I'm not seeing anything sinful about that, right? If you have a loan or whatever, you're paying interest, it's not like you're in sin. What can be sinful is putting usury out on other people, okay? But I want to just be very clear as far as, you know, just what the Bible says about this and get into maybe a little bit of the details, because I think you're going to find that there's an area where you're just like, I'm not sure if that's always wrong or if this is right or whatever, okay? I'll say this, there's enough warning that I think as Christians we should just try to stay away from it altogether, okay? So the preface here is that you should probably just stay away from it. I'm not trying to be a banker and run a bank that's putting out usury on people, okay? Does that mean that banks are wicked inherently or whatever? You know, that's another argument, but I'm going to get to that a little bit. And, you know, on my end, it's one of those things that I never really studied this out. I had two people ask me this question. They're like, what do you think about usury? And I'm like, honestly, I just never looked into it. It never really applied to me. I never really had a reason to worry about, you know, whether this is right or wrong or whatever, because I'm not a bank. You know, I'm not giving out loans to people and, like, collecting interest on it, okay? Now, go to Exodus 22 and verse 25. Exodus 22 and verse 25, it says, if thou lend money to any of my people, notice this, that is poor by thee. Okay, and the one thing that you'll see in a lot of these cases is that it's like the poor, okay? And keep reading there. It says, thou shalt not be to him as an usurer, neither shalt thou lay upon him usury. If thou at all take thy neighbor's raiment to pledge, thou shalt deliver it unto him by that the sun goeth down, for that is his covering only. It is his raiment for his skin, wherein shall he sleep, and it shall come to pass, when he crieth unto me, that I will hear, for I am gracious. Okay? So in this first case that we see about usury, it's basically saying, hey, you know, if you lend money to my people that's poor, okay? Meaning that the idea here is that in a lot of these cases, you're dealing with people that need money because they're just really, really poor, okay? Because the other, you say, well, what would be the other case that you need to lend money? Well, there's a lot of people that aren't poor that take out loans for different things. And they're not poor. It's not like they're just not being able to survive if they didn't do that. But, you know, they wanted something. They took out a loan and they're paying it and they're not poor. They're not like a pauper or in poverty, okay? But in this case, it's specifically saying, hey, if someone is poor, you lend them money, you do not charge interest on that person, okay? That's what it's stating here, okay? And there's two things to see there, my people and poor, okay? Now, go to Leviticus chapter 25. Leviticus chapter 25. So I'm going to show you in the law of Moses what it says about usury, okay? Because when you get to Deuteronomy 23, that's where it puts a monkey wrench in there, okay? Because at this point, you're going to see all these places that says, don't put usury, don't put usury, don't put usury, okay? So Leviticus chapter 25, verse 35. And for you kids out there that want to get candy, this is going to be a fun one to try to remember. So usury is what? Interest, okay? It means that if you get a loan, if you're taking out a loan for $25,000 and you have an interest rate, you know, of, let's say 2% or whatever, then they're charging you 2% interest for like a period of time, okay? And the bigger amount of money that you have that you are loaning out, the more interest you have to pay based off of that. And then as you pay it off, that principal goes down and then you pay less interest as you get down to the end of the loan. Okay. So the idea though is that you're not just paying back, let's say it was $25,000. You're not just paying that back. In the end, you're going to have a higher amount of money that you paid for that than if you just would have bought it straight up. Does that make sense? If you just had $25,000 and you bought whatever you're buying, like a car or whatever, then if you take it out with an interest rate, then you're going to be paying more in the end for that. Okay. Now, in Leviticus chapter 25 here, in verse 35, it says, and if thy brother be waxen poor and fallen in decay with thee, then Thou shalt relieve him, yea, thou, though he be a stranger or a sojourner, that he may live with thee, take thou no usury of him or increase, but fear thy God, that thy brother may live with thee. Thou shalt not give him thy money upon usury, nor lend him thy victuals for increase. Now, this is an interesting verse because now it's not just saying, like, my people. It's saying thy brother, whether he is a stranger or a sojourner, okay? So, you know, there's a lot, because you say, well, this is in Israel, this is back then, you know, who's this apply to? And, you know, it's basically saying, even if they're not an Israelite, but they're your brother, okay, and or they're, you know, they're just a sojourner, basically, and they're poor, they're waxing poor and decay, okay, so they're basically on their last robe, they don't have anything, and they just, you know, you're trying to, you're like, I'll loan you money, you know, the idea is that you don't charge interest for that. It's not saying it's a gift. It's not saying that they'll never pay it back. It's just saying that you don't get any increase after that, right? You don't get any extra because of that. Now here, Deuteronomy 23 in verse 19. Deuteronomy 23 and verse 19. Now, I have a principle that I'm going to get to when it comes to this as far as like why this sermon should be applicable to us, but I just want to go through these verses, you know, what it says in the law, and then let's unpack that. You know, this is what it says in the law, and then let's see where this applies, where this wouldn't apply, right? Deuteronomy 23 and verse 19, it says, thou shalt not lend upon usury to thy brother, usury of money, usury of victuals, usury of anything that is lent upon usury, unto a stranger. Thou mayest lend upon usury, but unto thy brother thou shalt not lend upon usury, that the Lord thy God may bless thee in all that thou settest thine hand to in the land whither thou goest to possess it. Okay? So, that's, you're like, that seems to contradict what it says in Leviticus. Well, the difference is, when it said don't, if they're a stranger, a sojourner, it says that he may live with thee. Okay? So it's people that are living there, but they're just not from there, right? But they're living in the land. He's basically saying, don't put usury on them. But in Deuteronomy 23, it says if they're a stranger, meaning that they're not living there, they're outside of Israel, then it says, unto a stranger, thou mayest lend upon usury, okay? Now, it doesn't say thou shalt, like, you know, that's a commandment to put usury on people, because I don't think that it you know, in all honesty, to get away from usury would be the best thing, okay? Meaning that that is showing that it's not always wrong, okay? That's the point I'm trying to get across, is that usury is not always wrong, okay? Now, the question is where does that line cross as far as in our life now, when would it be wrong to put out usury? So I'll say this. I personally believe that it's wrong for a believer to put usury out on another believer, okay? We're dealing with my people, my brother, you know, people that are of our nation, which is the holy nation, which is, you know, the true Israel, right? And that as believers, we should never be loaning each other money with usury, okay? That's my interpretation. But when you're out in the world, it is what it is, and usury's out there, and, you know, but this is where it gets into that hairy place there. What if you're running a bank? Do you check everybody's salvation before you before you give them a loan? Be like, are you a brother in Christ? You know, and you ask them if they're saved, and they're like, yeah, I'm saved. All right, 0%. You know, and then they're like, no, I'm not saved. And be like, all right, 12%. And they're like, I support Biden, 20%. Yeah, so. And so obviously that's where you get into this realm that I don't think that's, you know, and you say, well, then I just wouldn't run a bank. Well, you know, I can agree with you there. Okay. Banks make money other than interest, by the way. Okay. They make money in other ways besides charging interest on loans. Now, that is one of their big ways of making money. Okay. It's one of their top three, but there's two other ways that they can make money based off fees. Okay, so you say, well, how are they going to run? That's the question you would ask yourself, right? How are they going to lend out money to people that, you know, if they don't get anything out of it, right? Are they just going to be a charitable organization, right? Because you got to ask these real world questions, right? Let's say you want to buy a house, okay? How do you do it? You just have someone that just has hundreds of thousands of dollars just laying around and be like, I'll just give it to you with 0% interest. You know, good luck with that, trying to find that, okay? And so, but banks do make money on other ways. So there's other ways to get money and to make money, whether it's fees, and you're just like, I don't like fees. Well, you know, if they're gonna be exchanging money and they're gonna be doing all this service for you, they gotta get paid, okay? You can't just expect them to do it for free. They also make money based off interchange, okay? And especially in the world we live in, when it comes to you using a debit card or a credit card or whatever, they charge that place a certain fee to exchange money and they make money off that. They also make money off investments, okay? You have a savings account, you have money in there, then you know, the savings account, you can make money off that, okay? Now, that being said, is that there is a case where usury is not wrong. Okay. Now you could make the case of like, well, that was for Israel and it was just, you know, upon the Canaanites or just upon that. Well, the idea though is Deuteronomy's talking about they're taking out all those people, right? So I don't think you could really use the argument of like, well, you're doing it on them because they should have been wiped out. Well, the idea is that that principle should have been there whether they're wiped out or not, right? If they're completely wiped out, so you're dealing with just people that are strangers from Israel, right? And so, you know, but I think in the world, when you're dealing with a bank and you're like, I'm buying a house and they have a certain interest rate, you agree to it and you're willing to pay that extra amount because they're willing to front up the money at the beginning, you know, it's hard for me to say that they're wicked for doing that, okay? Or like a car loan or something like that, right? That they're wicked for charging some kind of interest because they're fronting the money to you to begin with. Now, in the cases that we're dealing with here, we're dealing with poor people that are in decay and don't have any money. They're not buying things that are, I guess, luxury or things that are not necessarily needed, like food and raiment. Does that make sense? Because food and raiment is things that are necessary, okay? And so you get into this gray area as far as, well, who's a stranger, you know, and who do you do that out to? Now, the conservative answer here is just don't deal with it at all, okay? But I'll say this, brothers in Christ, we should never be putting usury out on each other. That means in this church, if anybody ever lends you money, never put usury out on that person, okay? And my principle is, if I lend you money, I assume I'm never gonna see it again, okay? If I say, hey, I'll loan, you know, can you loan me $1,000? I'll just assume that I'll never see it again and I won't lend it unless I can give it up, unless I don't need it, and I can just give it up and walk away and not even worry about it. Because I don't want to hold a grudge on anybody, and I look at it this way. If they pay me back, it's a bonus, okay? If they don't, it is what it is, okay? Now, on the person that says, I'll pay you back, and then they don't, it's on them, okay? But to me, it's nothing. You know, I'm not going to, like, hold them against that. I'll just suffer to be defrauded, okay? So that's the principle that I think Christians should live by, is that you should never lend out money unless you're willing to kiss it goodbye. And you should never lend out money to your brother in Christ and say, all right, you owe me this much more for lending it out to you. Okay? I think that's wrong, and I think that's oppressing the poor. Now, go to Matthew chapter 25, because I'm going to show you that there's a case where usury is used in a good sense, actually the only place in the New Testament where it's used, but it's not talking about loans. Okay, so usury, like I said, usury is interest or increase, okay? So you can increase your money and it's not based off like an interest rate that's like accrued by a loan. Does that make sense? So the other way is investments, okay? And this is where I don't think investments are wrong. Now, do I think that you should just be going out and investing your money and that's how you make money, like being an investor? I think that is not a good way to live. And that's a thing that's going to, if that's your main means of income, then you're playing Russian roulette with the economy and all these different things, and you're not really producing anything to really earn that money, right? You know, wealth gotten by vanity, it talks about, I'm gonna misquote it, but it basically says it'll be lost, you know, I forget exactly how it says it. I'm getting that mixed up with something else where it says that, you know, will have wings and fly away or something like that. So that being said, I'm not here to say go get into the stock market and be an investor and all that, but I do not believe that's the same as accruing interest on a loan, lending, okay? Lending money and charging usury and investing money and getting increase on that is two different things. Does that make sense? So when we're dealing with usury, it could be talking about either one of those. Now, Matthew chapter 25, verse 14, we're dealing with the parable of the talents, okay? Notice what it says in verse 14. Just to get the context of this parable, it says, "For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods." So it starts off saying this is what heaven is like, okay? It's likening it unto this man that goes into a far country. Now, would anybody doubt that this parable is talking about the Lord Jesus Christ going away and then coming again, right? This is clearly what this is talking about. Now, in Luke 19, put your hand in Luke 19, kind of it's a parallel passage. Now, in this case, you're dealing with pounds and not talents, right? And each one gets a pound. 10 people get get 1 pound. And in the other one, you have 3 servants. One gets 5, the other gets 2, and the other gets 1, right? So it's a little different, but same principle. Notice what it says in Luke 19, verse 12. It says, "He said, therefore, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and to return." Okay? So kind of the same principle. The kingdom of heaven is likened to this, a man going into a far country. This one is a nobleman going into a far country. But go down to verse 24 of Matthew 25. So keep your hand in Luke 19. And we'll see that in both cases, when you're dealing with the wicked servant that didn't gain anything on his money, he didn't like go and make more money off of that, he's rebuked for it. Okay. Now, this isn't a sermon to get into whether this person was saved. I don't believe he was saved. Okay. I don't believe he lost his salvation, but I don't believe he was saved to begin with. I think you're dealing with a Judas, you know, someone that's a, you know, not an actual believer. But that's not the point I'm trying to make here. Verse 24, it says, "Then he which had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew thee that thou art an hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown and gathering where thou hast not strawed. And I was afraid and went and hid thy talent in the earth. Lo, there thou hast that is thine. His Lord answered and said unto him, Thou wicked and slothful servant, thou knewest that I reap where I sowed not and gather where I have not strawed." Notice this in verse 27. "Thou oughtest therefore to have put my money to the exchangers, and then at my coming I should have received mine own with usury." So would you say that the goodman of the house, or you know, the man right here, was wrong to say that? Okay? And basically what he's stating here, it'd be like this if I said, "Hey, I'm going to give you $5, and I want you to go out and multiply that." You would have been better off putting it in a bank in a savings account and accruing, you know, some kind of investment off of that. Does that make sense? Is what he's saying. It wouldn't have been as much, but it would have been better than nothing, right? And that's basically what he's stating. Now go to Luke chapter 19, because he's going to state, you say, "Well, what's the exchangers, you know, the exchangers?" Well, you can think of money exchanges, right? You think of, you know, investments and all that other stuff that's going on. In Luke 19, verse 20, it says, "And another came, saying, Lord, behold, here is thy pound, which I have kept laid up in a napkin. For I feared thee, because thou art an austere man. Thou takest up that thou layest not down, and reapest that thou didst not sow. And saith unto him, Out of thine own mouth I will judge thee, thou wicked servant. Thou knewest that I was an austere man, taking up that I laid not down, reaping that I did not sow." Sound familiar? It's pretty much the same speech that's going on with the other one, right? "Wherefore then gavest not thou my money into the bank, that at my coming I might have required mine own with usury." Okay? So I believe that, you know, when you're dealing with investments, it's not wrong. I'm not saying that that's how you should live your life. Okay? You know, because let's say you have a 401k or an IRA or something like that, right? You have a retirement plan. And, you know, I don't think that's wrong to have that. I don't think it's wrong to make money off that, because I'm not taking from the poor, right? Basically what you're doing when you do this, okay, is you're putting money into, you're investing into a company, and then the company, if it does well, makes more money, and that means that your stock raises in value, okay? Does that make sense? That's different than loaning money on somebody and pulling money out of them when they're trying to pay back a loan. Okay, those are two different things. Now, I personally don't plan on retiring. Okay, I have a 401k, but it's for my family. Okay, so that's how I view that. Okay, so you know where Paul says, you know, the children don't lay up for the parents, but the parents for the children. That's how I view it. Okay, I'm working, surviving, trying to pay, you know, the bills, all that stuff, and I have a retirement plan so that if I kick the bucket or you know, or whatever happens, I can, that my family will be taken care of. You know, that's my plan when it comes to that. Now, if that 401k falls apart, then so be it. I don't care. Okay. And actually, 2020, when they shut down the economy, you know, it was hard to look at my 401k when I got the quarterly assessment. You know, you're like, oh, like it took a dive, you know. But you know what? I didn't care. I don't care if it all went away. And ultimately, if it all goes away, then so what? I don't care. But I look at it as a bonus that, okay, you know, when I'm like older and, you know, just basically just not able to work anymore, that my kids will not have to like put up money. They won't have to pay funeral costs. They won't have to do any of this stuff. And maybe I'll have some extra money to help them out when they're in need, when, you know, they're raising a family and doing what they need to do. Okay, that's my plan with that. So I don't believe that's wrong, okay? Because, listen, I'll preach against retirement, okay? Because we need to work for the night is coming. You know, the night cometh when no man can work. I'm going to work, whether, you know, secularly or for the church or for God until I die, okay? So I'm not here to say, you know, I'm waiting for my retirement so I can just take it easy, you know, build up my barns, and eat, drink, and be merry, okay? That is not, I believe that's wrong. I think you should just work for Christ and keep working until you die. We'll rest when we die, okay? That's my attitude on that. But to say that I can't, you know, have money laid aside for my children or my family, I don't think that's unbiblical. Actually, I think that is biblical. Paul said it was biblical. And I don't believe, you know, 401ks or anything like that are wrong. Now, I think you should not get caught up in that or worry about it, okay? That's my advice, is don't worry about it. If it goes away, you know, so be it. But if not, it's there, and you know what? Then it's there for my children. And you know what? You can have different opinions on that and say, you know what? I don't think you should have a 401k, or I don't think you should try to put up anything for retirement. You should lay up store in heaven. Listen, of course you should lay up store for heaven. But when you read that story, it says this man laid up store, but not for the things of God. Okay, you can do both, by the way. You can have a savings account and live for God. Does that make sense? You know, just think about it. Let's say you just put money off into a savings account. Is that wrong? Is that wrong just to have money on the side or have an emergency fund or anything like that? I think that's wise. I think it's wise to just have some money that, you know, if something happens or whatever happens, you get into, you know, medical bills, anything like that, that is something that's good, okay? But you should not be saying, hey, I'm going to lay up. I got $1 million. Now I can just go live in the Bahamas and, you know, sip my sweet tea and, you know, sit on the beach, you know. I don't think that that's what God wants us to do as Christians, okay? Unless you're out soul winning in Barbados or Aruba or something like that and you're doing a missions trip or something like that. So that being said, usury in the sense of investment, I don't see that as being wrong. Obviously, there's wicked investments and there's wicked things like that, okay? But in all these things, you say, well, okay, if I work for a bank and I was a teller, but the bank charges usury on loans, therefore, am I not working for like a wicked organization? Okay, you wanna play that game. How about any place you work? How about any company you work for? You gonna go down that line? I mean, name a big corporation or company that does not do something wicked down the line somewhere, okay? So, you know, we're in the world. We can't fix all that. That's like saying, I'm going to, you know, boycott this because they do this. Now, if you want to boycott a certain company, I'm not against you, okay? But you can't say, like, that person's wicked because they're drinking Starbucks. You know, that person's wicked because they're eating this, you know? Or, you know, that person's wicked because they're eating Popeyes and not Chick-fil-A. You know Chick-fil-A is more Christian, right? And yeah, and no, but obviously that's being silly, but you know, it's one of those things that you can't go that far because you would never be able to work anywhere in most cases, okay? You say, well, I work for a company that it's all Christians. Well, God bless you, okay? But who does that company work for? Who does that company serve? Do they serve people that are wicked? Good luck. Good luck just serving righteous people and always working for people that are righteous. You know what? And when it comes to my job, I'll design for anybody, right? Money's green. When it comes to business, money's green. And you know what? The employer, that's the way you need to look at it. And as long as what you're doing particularly is not, you know, against the Bible, then that's what you need to be worried about, right? What is your job doing? What are you doing in your job? Are you doing predatory lending? Are you trying to find the poor people so you can give them a loan so you can take their house? Because that's what they did in 2008, 2009. When you had that recession, what did they do? They did predatory lending where they gave loans to the people they knew for sure were not going to be able to pay their loans. The economy crashed and the banks seized their houses. And now, see, let me give you a lesson on the Federal Reserve, okay, and fractional reserve banking. What they do is they print off a whole bunch of money, cause inflation, so people buy up a whole bunch of stuff. The economy crashes because you can't just print money. You know, you ever hear that phrase, money doesn't grow on trees? I think I remember that when I was a kid, but that's actually, they didn't learn that lesson in Congress. And they just print off money like it's growing on trees. You know, that causes inflation and it causes the value of the dollar to go down. And therefore, those people that you lend out this house to, when the economy crashes, they can't afford to pay it. The banks, who are just printing off money that's worth nothing, okay? Not worth anything. It doesn't have any intrinsic value. It's worth nothing. At that point, they haven't gained anything. But you know when they gain something? When they seize the houses of all those people that had to declare bankruptcy, and now they have capital. That's how it works. That's called predatory lending. And that's called, you know, oppressing the poor. Now the poor person has had to declare bankruptcy, has no credit, has no house, and now a servant, you know, to try to somehow make it in the world. That's wicked, okay? And when you're dealing with usury, especially what the Bible's talking about, and specifically it's talking about oppressing the poor, and that happens today in our world, okay? So just to give you an idea of how that works, how they use that to make unjust gain, okay? Because those banks got a lot of real estate and a lot of capital. Because listen, your money that's printed doesn't have any value. Okay, it only has value if people think it has value. It's like monopoly money. Okay, it's only worth as much as people think it is. Okay, so that being said, a house has intrinsic value. Right, you know, it doesn't leak. People can live in it. It's a nice place. It has material. Those materials are worth something. Intrinsic value, okay? And that's how they make money and make increase on unjust gain, okay? So that's obviously wrong. Predatory lending, all that stuff. And I do believe in a lot of cases that's what this is talking about. But I think in general, it's telling us, hey, you know, when it comes to the poor, we need to be merciful. We need to be charitable. We need to be like God and not, you know, kick them while they're down, okay? If you're going to help a poor person out by lending them money, you don't say, all right, I need 2.5% interest on that and make them pay interest as they're paying off that loan, okay? That is not what's supposed to be done, okay? I just want to go through some verses as far as what God thinks about those that oppress the poor. In Proverbs chapter 14 and verse 31, Proverbs chapter 14 and verse 31. And when I'm talking about the poor, I'm not talking about lazy people that just take handouts from the government. I'm talking about people that work hard, but that are struggling to get by. That's what I'm talking about. Okay, I'm not talking about people that are on welfare, that just refuse to work, that are able-bodied people, that are just taking handouts, and you know what? That's not the poor. Okay, the poor are those that go to work an everyday job, that are putting in at least their 40 hours a week, doing what they can, trying to provide for their families, but are just, you know, struggling to get by. That's who we're dealing with here. Proverbs 14, verse 31. It says, "He that oppresseth the poor reproacheth his maker, but he that honoreth him hath mercy on the poor." So if you oppress the poor, and by the way, if you put out usury to the poor like that, you are oppressing the poor. It says, and that reproaches your maker. Go to Proverbs 17, verse 5. Proverbs 17, verse 5. Proverbs 17, verse 5, it says, "Whoso mocketh the poor reproacheth his maker, and he that is glad at calamity shall not be unpunished." Because those do probably go hand in hand, you know, people that are just like happy if someone gets in a car wreck, or, you know, happy when something happens to somebody, you're just like, what is wrong with you? That's as much as saying, like, you mock the poor and be like, "Oh, look at that poor person over there. They can't even afford to buy a soda," or whatever. That's wicked. Like, that, like, you just want to punch that person in the face. Now, I wouldn't do it, because I'd be a brawler, you know. I can't do that, but you can do that. No, I'm just kidding. Like, "Brother Anthony, you know what to do." No, obviously, I don't mean to do that. But obviously, you know, that is wicked. To oppress the poor, to mock the poor, you know, God sees that. And go to Psalm 12, Psalm 12. Psalm 12. Psalm 12, verse 5, it says, "For the oppression of the poor, for the sighing of the needy, now will I arise, saith the Lord. I will set him in safety from him that puffeth at him." And you say, man, who's puffing at the poor? All the politicians that are out there today. You say, well, they're for all the wealth. Again, I'm not talking about the welfare state that doesn't want to work, that's voting them in, or, you know, putting their stamp of approval. I'm talking about hardworking people that are getting abused by the system, that are getting taxed out the rear end, and they're just trying to make it by. That's who I'm talking about. And you know what? God sees that. God sees that when they oppress the poor, they mock the poor. And go to Psalm 109. Psalm 109, verse 30. Psalm 109, verse 30. So I'm really, what I'm trying to show you here is that God cares for the poor. And he's basically saying, hey, listen, I'm going to hear their cause. It's not going to be unheard. And if you think about it, if there's a priority list of who God's going to listen to, it's going to be the poor. It's going to be those that are needy, in need. Okay? In Psalm 109, verse 30, it says, "I will greatly praise the Lord with my mouth. Yea, I will praise him among the multitude, for he shall stand at the right hand of the poor to save him from those that condemn his soul." Psalm 140 and verse 12, it says, "I know that the Lord will maintain the cause of the afflicted and the right of the poor." Proverbs 21 and verse 13. Proverbs 21 and verse 13. And if you're poor today, you know, then this should be comfort. And I don't think anybody in here is rich. I wouldn't say anybody in here is like in poverty. You know what I mean? So, but I would say that most people have a roof over their head, they have clothes on their back, and they have food, you know. And having food and raiment, let us be there with content, okay? But Proverbs 21, verse 13, it says, "Whoso stoppeth his ears at the cry of the poor, he also shall cry himself, but shall not be heard." Now, this is not talking about those panhandling bozos that are sitting at the corner when you're at a stoplight. Let me just nip that in the bud real quick. You say, man, I feel like God's going to judge me if I don't put money in their hand. God may judge you if you put money in their hand. They're a bunch of shysters, a bunch of leeches sitting out there trying to get money, sitting on the rear end when they should be working. And you know what? You say, well, I can't believe you'd say that. Listen, the person that is in charge of the homeless in Morgantown said that to me. And, well, he didn't say it that way. But he basically said, listen, don't give them money. That's the person that's in charge of the homeless. That's his modus operandi, is to help out the homeless. He's like, they know where to get food, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. They know where to go to get a house and to get shelter. They know where to go to, so that we can give them a job and do all this stuff. They know where to go, but they make more money doing that. And so that's not who God's talking about here. It's like, oh, you know, you look past that person that's out there panhandling. No, that's not what this is talking about. I'm talking about real poor people. People that are working hard, trying to get by, come on hard times and need help. Okay? And you turn your ear away from that. And in Proverbs 29, verse 7, it says, "The righteous considereth the cause of the poor, but the wicked regardeth not to know it." Proverbs 31, dealing with King Lemuel and what he should be doing as a king and why he shouldn't be drinking alcohol, by the way. So he doesn't pervert judgment. But in verse 8, it says, "Open thy mouth for the dumb in the cause of all such as are appointed to destruction. Open thy mouth, judge righteously, and plead the cause of the poor and needy." It's basically saying, be a mouthpiece for the poor and needy. Be a mouthpiece for those that can't speak. And when I see the mouth of the dumb and the cause of all such as are appointed to destruction, I think of the babies that are being murdered every single day. And so what? You know what? God hears that. And as a king, King Lemuel, his mother said, you need to speak for those that can't speak, that are appointed unto destruction. That is a righteous king. And someone that pleads for the cause of the poor. So God cares for the poor. How about this? Go to James chapter 2. James chapter 2. Ecclesiastes 5:8 says this. It says, "If thou seest the oppression of the poor and violent perverting of judgment and justice in a province, marvel not at the matter. For he that is higher than the highest regardeth, and there be higher than they." Okay. So it's basically saying he that's highest, higher than the highest, meaning that God, right? God regardeth it. And there's higher than the person that's allowing it to happen. Okay? That's what he's saying. So God sees all that. God sees the oppression of the poor. He sees the perverting of judgment. It's not that he's putting a deaf ear to that or a blind eye to that. He sees that and he regards it. James chapter 2 and verse 1 here says, "My brethren, have not the faith of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, with the respect of persons. For if there come unto your assembly a man with a gold ring and goodly apparel, and there come in also a poor man in vile raiment, and ye have respect to him that weareth the gay clothing, and say unto him, Sit thou here in a good place, and say to the poor, Stand thou there, or sit here under my footstool. Are ye not then partial in yourselves to become judges of evil thoughts?" So he's basically saying, You're regarding this rich man higher than the poor man. So that, what are you doing? You're oppressing the poor. You're oppressing the poor because you care more about that rich man and what he's going to bring to the offering, what he's going to bring to you, how he's going to help you. But really, you should be thinking of the poor as far as they're just as much a person as the rich person, and you should not put one above the other just based off their income. So if someone comes in here and, you know, their tithe is like half of what everybody else is or a quarter of what everybody else is, do you think I regard them any less than the person that has more of a tithe? Listen, I tell you to tithe because that's what the Bible says, but I don't really care. You know, like, it's no, I don't care if you don't tithe. That's between you and God, okay? And I don't look at anybody. You know, by the way, a lot of people pay cash. So I don't even know if they tithe, okay? So it doesn't bother me. And I'm not looking at that. I don't care, okay? I mean, I care. I care that you're right with God. So I'm going to tell you what the Bible says you should do. But what I'm saying is that it doesn't bother me, you know, and I'm not looking at it and be like, well, that's a tither, you know. And or we don't want to lose that person. Because, man, their tithe is doing great things, you know, or whatever. And just having respect to person for that. Notice what it says. Keep reading there. It says, "Hearken, my beloved brethren. Hath not God chosen the poor of this world rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom, which he hath promised to them that love him? But ye have despised the poor." So notice that he's rebuking them harshly here. It says, you have despised the poor. He's talking to brethren. Despising the poor and respecting the rich over the poor. Do not rich men oppress you and draw you before the judgment seats? Do they not blaspheme that worthy name by the which you are called? And so, you know what? We should have a love and respect for the poor. You know, you should look at the poor and be like, there's someone that's going to be rich in faith, most likely. That person's probably going to end up getting saved, and that person may end up serving God better than any rich person ever would. Okay? Because they just have a different mindset because they need God. They're in need of God. They're rich in faith. Whether it's just to get saved or even rich in faith when it comes to after you're saved and just the faith they have in God to do great things, that person will probably do greater things than any rich person ever would do. Now, that doesn't exclude rich people and be like, rich people, you can do nothing, right? But you know what? It's as hard as it is for a rich man to get saved, it's probably as hard as for a rich man to serve God. Let's just be honest. Because you have all this money and you're not using it because you're living for God, doing all this stuff, and you can't enjoy your riches. You know what? The pleasures of this world are going to end up choking those people in a lot of cases. Okay? So we need to have a respect and love for the poor. And you know what? If a poor person needs our help, we should help them. Now, do you think that usury, for example, if someone that was unsaved that I knew needed money, they'd be like, well, the Bible says I can do it to strangers when it comes to usury. Going back to usury here, do you think I'd be like, I'm going to stick it to him? Or do you think that in general you should be like, I'm not going to charge usury on anybody? Okay, I think it's explicitly taught that believers, brethren, you should not be doing that. Okay. But even those that are outside the church, and if I was dealing with an unsaved person that was like, you know, someone I knew, they needed help, or they were a family member and they were unsaved, whatever the case may be, you should have that same principle, okay? Go to Ezekiel chapter 18. Ezekiel chapter 18. Ezekiel chapter 18. Because I want you to see again that there's another place that is talking about the poor, okay? So you say, well, where do you stand on this? Well, I personally, and listen, I'm not exactly like here to say that you couldn't change my mind on this. Is to me, this is not like a primary doctrine that is something that you have to have down or whatever. Now, if you're owning a bank, I think you should probably look into this, okay? But I personally don't believe it's wrong to, if you're saying, hey, I'm going to give you a loan on this car or whatever, and to charge interest on that, you know, just outside of church, obviously not in church, right? You're not doing that for church or, you know, church is not charging interest on anything, okay? But I don't believe that's wrong. Now, I do believe it's wrong if someone is poor and they can't afford anything and then you're charging usury on them. But if you're talking about luxury items or things that are higher end, you're not poor, and you're not in the dumps when it comes to, like, you're not just in complete decay or being poor, then in those cases, if you're charging usury on somebody, I don't think it's necessarily inherently wrong, okay? Now, I'm not dogmatic on that, okay? So, but that's where it gets into, like, I bought a house, and they're charging interest on that. Be like, you're wicked, I'm taking it, okay? I bought a car, you're wicked for charging me usury, but I'm taking it. Now, I'll say this. Obviously, if you're getting used or if you're paying interest, you're not in sin, right? It's never wrong to be paying interest, you know, getting defrauded, right? Getting defrauded by paying interest. It's not like you're in sin for being defrauded, okay? Or, you know, having to pay more than you are or whatever, or you should. But, you know, I don't believe personally that when you're dealing with items like that, you know, when it's not things that are essential items, then, you know what, I think that you get into that case of Deuteronomy 23, where, you know what, on strangers, you're out in the world, you're dealing with the world and their system and money and all that stuff, that's just the way things work. But as believers and within the realm of church and you know, the holy nation of being believers, we should not be doing that to each other, okay? And that's where you get into the Israel with the brothers and strangers that are sojourning with us, that's what that's talking about with not putting out usury, and especially not to the poor, okay? But I believe not doing it to the poor should apply across the board, okay? Whether, you know, because when it talks about putting it out on strangers, it doesn't say, well, the poor stranger, though. It doesn't mention that they're poor. It's just saying to the stranger, okay? So in Ezekiel chapter 18, just another place to kind of show you this. It's talking about people that do right, and whether their father did wrong or not. If you're a son of somebody that was wicked, but you're doing right, then you're going to be judged according to your own righteousness or sins, right? It's basically saying that the son shall not be put to death for the sins of the father, neither shall the father be put to death for the sins of the son, right? This is that principle. And in verse 14, it says, now, lo, if he beget a son that seeth all his father's sins, which he had done, and considereth and doeth not such like, that hath not eaten upon the mountains, neither hath lifted up his eyes to the idols of the house of Israel, hath not defiled his neighbor's wife. So he's basically listing off the things that he's not doing that are bad. Okay, keep reading. Neither hath oppressed any, hath not withholden the pledge, neither hath spoiled by violence, but hath given his bread to the hungry, and hath covered the naked with a garment, that hath taken off his hand from the poor, that hath not received usury nor increase, hath executed my judgments, hath walked in my statutes. He shall not die for the iniquity of his father, he shall surely live. Okay, so this is just talking about, you know, being right with God, all that stuff. But notice how being poor and exacting usury are almost always being used together, okay? Afflicting the poor with usury, all that stuff is what I believe it's dealing with in a lot of these cases where it's wicked to oppress the poor and using usury to oppress the poor, okay? So go to Luke chapter 6, Luke chapter 6. So getting into the idea of giving, okay, and what we should be doing. And this is where I get into the idea that I don't believe, listen, obviously, when it comes to believers in the church, we should not be exacting usury on anybody. I don't believe you should ever be doing that, okay? If you are doing that, I believe that you would be in sin. I believe that's going against principles in the Bible when it comes to that. You get outside into the world with banks and all that stuff, you know what? You know, we can have that discussion, okay? You know, I tend to not think it's always wrong for them to do it on loans and all that stuff. I do believe predatory lending and all that stuff, and the way usury is even defined today with an exorbitant amount of interest rate or interest rates that increase over time, like all that stuff. Obviously, you can get into wickedness when it comes to that. But if you're just dealing with a fixed interest rate that you are agreeing to and you're saying, listen, I want this money up front. I'm going to pay you a premium for it pretty much. And you know what? Let's do this because I want to get it now rather than later, okay, then that's, I don't think, inherently wrong, okay, and where you get in Deuteronomy 23, where, you know, in the world with strangers and dealing with all that stuff, then, you know, it's not inherently wrong. But you can have the discussion, you can say it's always wrong, and I'm not against you, okay, but to me, there's cases like Deuteronomy 23 where, you know, I think you can have a discussion as far as what that's talking about. Now, in Luke 6 and verse 27 here, dealing with loving your enemies, notice what it says in verse 27. It says, but I say unto you, which hear, love your enemies. Do good to them which hate you, bless them that curse you, and pray for them which despitefully use you. And unto him that smiteth thee on the one cheek, offer also the other. And him that taketh away thy cloak, forbid not to take thy cloak also, or coat also. Give to every man that asketh of thee, and of him that taketh away thy goods, ask them not again. So what are you dealing with here? Being defrauded in a lot of these cases, right? They're taking stuff from you or they're doing something to you and you're basically just suffering to be defrauded. You know, people that are just harming you. We're not talking about haters of God here, okay? We're talking about people that are just, you know, not being good to you personally. Verse 31, it says, and as ye would that men should do to you, do ye also to them likewise. For if ye love them which love you, what thank have ye? For sinners also love those that love them. And if ye do good to them which do good to you, what thank have ye? For sinners also do even the same. And if ye lend to them of whom ye hope to receive, what thank have ye? For sinners also lend to sinners to receive as much again. Now, this isn't even talking about usury. Okay, it says as much again, meaning that you're just gaining back what you lended. Okay, what does it say? Verse 35, but love your enemies and do good and lend, hoping for nothing again. And your reward shall be great, and you shall be the children of the highest, for he is kind unto the unthankful and to the evil. Be ye therefore merciful, as your Father also is merciful. So this is dealing with not, these are dealing with your enemies, okay? Your enemies, he's saying, lend to them, hoping you don't receive anything in return. Okay? Why? Because your reward will be great in heaven, because you're giving, hoping that you don't receive. And it's just kind of like this when it talks about, you know, if you make a meal, right? If you make a feast, don't, you know, you're better off making that for someone that you know could never pay you back. Okay? Because the idea is that you're giving, and you're not giving to get something back in return, right? You're giving just because you want to help them out. And I don't believe that he's saying give so that, you know, basically you know, just to spite them or something like that. I believe you're just like, you know what, I'm going to help you out. And I hope, you know, and just hope that you don't receive anything back. That's the attitude we should have with lending, whether it's with a saved Christian that we love and all that. But how about the people that hate us? Are you willing to lend them and just hope that you never see anything again? So tell me that that would be the case, okay? So it's not saying, you know, don't put usury on your brother, but just stick it to your enemy, okay? That's not what it's saying, okay? The Bible's saying, hey, do good to them as well. Go to Romans chapter 15. Romans chapter 15, dealing with the poor saints that are at Jerusalem when it comes to giving. So what I want to get to here is just the fact of the idea of giving, okay? And putting usury on that is not righteous. It is not something that we should ever be doing. And I just want to give you some principles about what your heart should be like when you're giving to people, okay? It should be just like, you know what? I just hope that this works out. I hope I never receive anything again, okay? Romans chapter 15, verse 25, it says, "But now I go unto Jerusalem to minister unto the saints, for it hath pleased them of Macedonia and Achaia to make a certain contribution for the poor saints which are at Jerusalem." So we have people in Macedonia and Achaia that are just making a contribution or giving to these poor saints that are at Jerusalem. It says, "And it hath pleased them verily, and their debtors they are. For if the Gentiles have been made partakers of their spiritual things, their duty is also to minister unto them in carnal things. When therefore I have performed this and have sealed to them this fruit, I will come by you into Spain." And basically what it's stating here is that the church of Jerusalem sent out people to get them saved, and they're sending back just money, you know, to help them with food or whatever they need. And he's basically saying, you know what, they got you saved, you should probably help them out. You know, it's basically what it's coming down to. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 8. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. And the idea with lending people money or just even giving to people, you should never give what you can't lose. Okay? And this is why I'm always against this idea of like giving out or basically saying, I'm going to give this much to missions or to the church, and I don't think I could even make it. It doesn't make financial sense. And I'm just going to do that, and hopefully God will come in and give me the money somehow. And I've heard all these crazy stories from Baptist churches where it's like, well, I put down this number, and I knew there was no way I would ever be able to pay that. But bless God, I got a check in the mail for that amount of money and all this crazy stuff. I'm like, that's Pentecostalism. That's some weird stuff right there. And that's not a Bible principle. The Bible principle is not saying, I'm going to give more money than what I have. That's never a Bible principle. Okay, and I'm going to nip that in the bud real quick right here. Okay, so you'll never hear me preach, or if you do, shove this sermon in my mouth. You'll never hear me preach, hey, you just need to give more than what you think you can handle and let God work. You know, you want to see God work? Then, you know, give your whole paycheck and see if God will replenish that. It's like, no. No, that is not a Bible principle, okay? And verse 9 here, so 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9, it says, "For ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich." So the idea is that, okay, you know, it's better for us to give up our riches to make other people rich, you know, and, you know, the principle obviously of Jesus dying on the cross for our sins, you know, coming down from glory and being made a little lower than the angels, right? Verse 10 there says, "And herein I give my advice, for this is expedient for you, who have begun before, not only to do, but also to be forward a year ago. Now, therefore, perform the doing of it, that as there was a readiness to will, so there may be a performance also out of that which ye have. For if there be first a willing mind, it is accepted." Notice this. We're talking about giving, okay? "According to that a man hath, and not according to that he hath not." Okay? So when it's talking about contributions or giving, it's according to what you have, okay? Not according to what you don't have. You don't just give out money that you don't have. And it says in verse 13, "For I mean not that other men be eased and ye burdened." Okay? So it's basically saying, don't give out money that you can't afford to give out, because I don't want them to be eased, and now you're in their situation. Okay? That's not how it works. It's not how it should work. Notice in verse 14, but by an equality that now at this time, notice this, if you don't mind underlining or if you want to underline, your abundance, okay? So when you're giving, it's out of your abundance. It's not out of like, oh man, I need to pay the electric bill, but you know what? I need to give this extra money. No, you need to pay the bills, get, you know, food on the table for your family. And then after that, if you have abundance and you want to give, then that's what we're talking about here, okay? Money that you have that you don't need for anything else, that you don't need to live, okay? Your abundance may be a supply for their want, that their abundance also, notice this, that their abundance also may be a supply for your want. So it basically works both ways. Let's say you have abundance right now and you're like, I want to help out this family. I want to help out these people. I have a little extra money right now. I'm going to help them out. They're in need, okay? The same thing would apply if I'm in need, right? I'm falling on hard times. And then another family says, you know what? You help. You know, it's one of those things that it doesn't matter if it's the same family, but it could end up being the same family. You can end up helping out a family, and then they all of a sudden are in an abundance, and you're falling on hard times, and they give it back to you. There's equality. Notice, though, this is free will offerings here. This is charitable. This is not forced. This is not a communistic society right here in the church. This is just stating that this is what we should be doing, okay? This is out of your own free will. You should be saying, hey, I have abundance. I'm going to help them out. They have abundance, they're going to help me out. And the idea is that we help each other out and to where you don't have people that just have a whole abundance and a whole bunch of people that are just struggling in the church, okay, and just can't make ends meet. The idea is that we help out those that need help out of our abundance. Can I say that again? Out of our abundance. Not according to that a man, it's according to the man hath, not according to what he hath not. So it's based off what you have, not saying, all right, I'm going to put this number out there and hopefully God will supernaturally give me this money, okay? I have a fixed income, but you know what? Somehow I know I'm going to win the lottery. No, I'm just kidding. That is not what you should be doing. I'm going to get this, you know, certain amount of money that's going to come in the mail. This is going to happen. Someone's just going to give me a gift. This is going to happen. Listen, that's playing Russian roulette with your finances. And that is not a biblical principle. Actually, that's quite opposite of what it says. The Bible says it's out of your abundance and, it should be what you have. Okay, now, the last verse there says, as it is written, he that had gathered much had nothing over, and he that had gathered little had no lack. This actually tells you what that whole purpose was. The manna, when they would gather the manna, right? They would gather the manna for their households, and on Friday, they would gather more, right? But it's basically saying, if you gathered a whole bunch more than everybody else, then you wouldn't have any more than that, than what you needed. And if someone gathered little, they would have just as much. And the idea is that, why? Because the person that gathered more would fill in for the gap of the person that gathered little. Does that make sense? Basically, there's an equality that was going on. So you don't have this person that's just, you know, taking all the manna, and you just didn't get there in time, and you're like, man, I got to feed my family with this little amount. No, the abundance is supposed to come over to that person. Okay, does that make sense? And that there's an equality, meaning that, hey, we're all doing all right. Okay, I'm not saying that we all need to make the same income or we live the same lifestyle or anything like that. But when it comes to just living and not being in poverty and not being in just this poor state where you're in deep poverty and, you know, can't pay the bills, can't afford to feed your family, that should never happen in a church. Okay. And as long as I'm the pastor here, that will never happen to anybody in our church if I have anything to do about it. But listen, we have a church that cares, and I guarantee that it wouldn't just be me that says that. But that is what, you know, the Bible teaches on this. Now, the Bible also says, go to 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 6, next chapter over. When it comes to giving, you know what? God does restore that, okay? Now, people take this principle too far and say, well, you know, if you sow bountifully, then you're going to reap bountifully. It's like, yeah, but you don't sow out what you can't afford to lose. Okay, that's the problem. You can't negate chapter 8 to go too far with chapter 9. Okay, you don't give out more than you can afford, but you should give out as much as you can afford. Does that make sense? Like, as much as you can give and get by, then that's what you should do. Okay, because it says in verse 6, but this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly. He which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. This applies in so many things. Think of soul winning. The more you go soul winning, the more people are going to get saved. Isn't that true? The more doors you knock, the more people that are going to be willing to hear. So the same thing goes with giving. The more you give, the more you're going to receive. Okay? And keep reading there. It says, every man according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. So notice that. He's basically saying, hey, you know, you shouldn't just be like, well, it's my duty to give this to you. Here you go. No, God loveth a cheerful giver. You know what the Bible says also? In Acts chapter 20, it says, to remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. And you know, when Christmas comes around, I love giving out gifts more than I love receiving gifts. Okay? It's a joy to get something for somebody that they like, you know, and to see the joy that they got something that they enjoy and all that stuff. You know, I'd rather way more give out gifts than to receive them. Because a lot of times you receive a gift, it's kind of embarrassing, you know, like, I don't deserve this, you know, why am I getting this thing, you know? But you're thankful, but you're kind of, you know, it's not as comfortable as when you give it out to somebody and can enjoy seeing them happy. Now, God loveth the cheerful giver, and you know what? We need to be bountiful when it comes to that. So that being said, when it comes to usury, do you see how that goes against all those principles right there? That you're supposed to give hoping to receive nothing again. You know, you should be giving to people that you know would never be able to pay you back, nor should you want them to pay you back. Okay? And that's why, you know, when I give something out, most of the time I'm not saying this, I'm just like, that's a gift. Because I don't even want to put a burden on them that, hey, you should pay this back without usury. Okay? You should be like, that's a gift, don't worry about it, you know, nothing. You know, I don't want anything back. And, you know, you can put a little bit of like, I'll be offended if you give me anything back. No, I'm just kidding. But the thing is that you should be obviously doing it. Why? Because you love them. You should do it cheerfully, not grudgingly. And you should always do it out of your abundance. You shouldn't be just taking money that's for your kids, and now your kids have to eat beans and cornbread for the next week because you didn't have enough money in your bank account because you gave it to someone else, okay? Because the Bible says, you know, I don't want them to be eased in you. And want, you know, it should be just out of your abundance, okay? So, but usury, when it comes to interest, that should never be done in this church. We'll never give out money to anybody and charge usury on that. And we should never be doing that amongst ourselves when it comes to giving people. I'm not going to do that on an enemy when it comes to giving out to people and lending money to people. But when you get into the world, that's where you get into that other realm, okay? So you say, well, you never really answered my question as far as should I work for a bank? Okay. Well, like I said, investments, I think that's a different deal. Obviously, if you're not dealing with wicked investments and wicked, you know, dealings and predatory things like that, I don't think that should be your main source of income. If you want my personal opinion, I don't think you should be an investor as your main source of income. Okay. I think that's wealth gotten by vanity. You're not producing anything. You're not contributing anything to society. All you're doing is just taking other people's money and making money off of that. And a bank at least has some purpose in life. You know, you have a bank, you're getting, you know, you're helping people get this or that, and whatever the case may be, okay? So, but I would say this. If you're not ultimately getting interest personally from somebody, I don't think it's wrong to work at a bank, right? If you're not personally getting that interest from somebody, like, you know, like they're literally paying you interest, then I don't think it's wrong. And we could have that argument as far as what about the bank? You know, is the person that owns the bank, are they the wicked ones? Are they in the wrong for doing that? You know, I think it may depend on the type of loan. It may depend on who they give the loan to. You know, is it luxury or necessity? There may be questions in there that has to be answered there. And honestly, I don't see a clear cut, you know, like, boom, this is what that's talking about when it says you may do it for a stranger, of how far you could take that. I think as a biblical principle, stay away from it. Okay? When in doubt, be conservative. You know, when we deal with structures, when in doubt, make it stout. You know, that's our motto when it comes to structural engineering. But when it comes to, if you have doubtful disputations, you're better off being on the conservative realm with it. And yes, I do think that there are cases where usury would not be wrong, but I'm also not dogmatic on where those cases would be, okay? So I'm just being honest with you. So you know what I would say? I'm not gonna do it at all in any case. I'm not gonna start a bank and start putting usury out on loans or anything like that, but I'm not about to go up to the bank and say, you guys are wicked for giving me that loan and putting interest on that. How dare you put interest on that? No, I'm not gonna do that, okay? So I hope that makes sense to some certain extent. Hopefully the young ones out here, I can ask you a question about usury. But usury is interest that's made off of money, okay? So in the Bible, it's just simply that. It's just an increase off of money, okay? And you gotta use context of when it's talking about what, but ultimately we should be cheerful givers, we should be lending money, hoping nothing in return, and definitely not be charging usury or interest on any loans that we give out as Christians in the church building or with friends and all that stuff, okay? So dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for today and just pray that you'd be with us throughout the rest of this week. And Lord, we just pray that you'd be with us as we go to our jobs and Lord, just help us to always be glorifying to you. And Lord, with these doubtful disputations or just different things where we're worried about certain things, I pray that you'd give us clarity and help us to know that, hey, what we're doing is right, or if it is wrong, Lord, to bring it right to light as far as what we should be doing. But Lord, I just pray that we would be abundantly clear on what we should be doing, what we shouldn't be doing when it comes to principles in the Bible. And Lord, we just love you and pray all this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.